Thanks, Kyle. Well, before I start, I promised I wouldn't, but I have to by telling you that Kyle Reyes is also a thespian and starred in a elementary school production of Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory and played, I believe, Willy Wonka. And then, after learning that information, I found out that Mark Weisenberg played the same role in his, where are you, Mark? Yeah, yes, so give him a, and I think maybe if we have some time left over, which we probably will, we'll invite those two up here to sing, you know, the song that, what's that famous Willy Wonka song? You know what I'm talking about. So now they're hoping and sweating that they're going to have time to do that. Hey, well, you probably don't recognize me, and that is because I look nothing like the picture that you have in your program. And that has everything to do with the fact that I'm currently at this moment in costume. In fact, I'm wearing a wig. Surprise, surprise. So we'll get rid of that. I am right now... today, before I came here, now my hair is going to be awesome, isn't it? Before I came here, and right as soon as I'm done here, I'm filming the Romeo and Juliet project, which is a co-project with the theater department and the digital media department. So the two departments are coming together and filming a movie. And so I am in it, and I'm playing Lord Capulet, who's Juliet's abusive, angry, alcoholic father, typecasting. And that's where I'll be right as soon as we're done. I'm going to go back to my drinking and slapping people. But happy to be here with you today and grateful that you came after lunch. It's always a difficult time to talk to people right after lunch because everyone wants to sleep, but try to stay awake. Linda, this is Linda Moore. Do you all know Linda Moore? Clap for her because she's fantastic. When Linda said to me, she asked me to speak to you today, and I didn't know what I could talk about for an hour. This seems like a long time. In my classes, you know, I'll talk for 5 minutes, and then we all roll on the floor or give back rubs or just whatever creepy thing you can think of happens in a theater class. We do in my classes. So even though I'm used to teaching classes that are 50 to 60 minutes long, it's very atypical for me to actually speak that long. So I've actually have been a little bit nervous and I asked Linda what would be appropriate for me to talk about, and she says, well, talk about whatever you like. And I said, well, I like Shakespeare. And she said, great. And I said, do you have any advice for me? And she says, don't be boring. That's my English accent for Linda. Don't be boring. And I thought, well, I'm talking about Shakespeare. Everyone's going to be so bored. And then I thought to myself, no, that's not true, because in my mind, there is nothing more exciting than Shakespeare. So I really am going to be talking to you about Shakespeare for the next little bit. But I promise that if you'll stay with me, you will learn to love Shakespeare, hopefully the way that I love Shakespeare. I always think that it doesn't matter what someone talks about, as long as they're passionate about it, it can be fascinating. I mean, I hate math. I shouldn't say hate, but I do. But listening to someone passionately talk about their love for math is exciting for me. And so that's what I want to talk about with you today. And so, Linda, I'm going to take your advice and go with what I love and talk about that. She says it's okay. She's also medicated. She just had surgery. So I don't know if she knows what she's agreeing to right now. Before I get into Shakespeare, though, maybe it would just be useful to talk to you about maybe my journey a little bit and how I ended up as a performer and as a director. As a child, I was not really one of those kids that you see a lot of times that loves to get up and perform. I wasn't that outgoing. I was just kind of a normal kid. And it's interesting. A lot of times people will say to me, oh, you've got to meet my granddaughter. Or you've got to meet my son. He is an actor. He loves to get up and sing and dance in front of people and show off. And I always want to say, that doesn't make him an actor. That just makes him kind of irritating. But I don't ever say that. because I think that would hurt feelings. But, you know, typically, people that go into this particular profession aren't necessarily the people that you would think that need a lot of attention. Certainly there are some. You'll see some here later on. But for the most part, a lot of them are serious about this as an art form. It's a craft. It's something that they love to do. And So that was kind of me as a child. My mother had 9 kids, and so during the summertime, she would do everything that she could think of to get rid of us. And so she, my first exposure to the theater as an actor was she signed my sister and me up for a summer camp that did drama. Drama, by the way, is a word that we don't really use very much on the university level, but drama is definitely a word that they use in the elementary school classroom. And anyway, so it was a drama camp, and they were doing a production of Oedipus Rex. Now, these people are laughing because they know this. Oedipus Rex is about a guy who, there's a prophecy that he will murder his father and then marry his mother, and then I think they have a baby together, and then he finds out that it's his mother and father, and he gouges his eyes out because he's horrified. This is an old Greek play. Well, they were doing this play at the elementary school drama camp, and my mom just dropped me off. She didn't know. She had so many other kids to worry about. So my sister and I went, and I got cast as Oedipus, and I was 7. And my sister got cast as Jocasta, the mother, who I supposedly marry and have a child with. And that was kind of my first experience with theater. We took it very seriously, and I learned a ton of lines, and I can still remember them, which is interesting because, you know, as a kid, you can always remember little things you memorize, and I can still remember. Oh, let's bring the lights down for this story, shall we? So anyway, that was kind of my first exposure to performing, and I really loved it. It was really fun for me, and I thought I might stick with it. The next thing I can kind of remember was more in high school, and in high school, my senior year, my high school was doing a production of The King and I, and all that I knew about The King and I was that the king shaved his head, and he didn't wear a shirt, and I thought, well, this is a great part. I wasn't bald then, but I felt like I looked really awesome without my shirt on, and so I tried out for the play, and I wasn't the best singer. And I really wasn't the best dancer. But, you know, they put us through our paces, and we all had to sing, and they all made us dance. And then, sure enough, they asked all the boys to take their shirts off. I don't know if they could still do that legally now, but this was in the 90s, 80s maybe. And so we all took our shirts off, and I felt very proud of myself. And sure enough, I was cast as the king of Siam. And I... You know, looking back at pictures of myself from that time, I know it didn't have anything to do with my shirt being off. But in my mind, it did. It had everything to do with that. And because of that play, there was a recruiter. I'm from Provo, and this was here just at Provo High School. There was a recruiter from BYU that came and saw the show and offered me a scholarship to go to school at BYU as a theater major. And that's really how I became involved in theater in college. I had no intention of doing it. So oftentimes I like to think of myself as having gotten into BYU because I looked so good without my shirt on. And still do to this day. I still think that. You know, and then that led to a master's program, and then that led to a PhD. And I sometimes wonder if that PhD is all contingent on how good I look shirtless. I like to tell myself that anyway, because I'm not that smart. So there was that. Then, of course, you know, in college, I did a lot of theater just to kind of keep a scholarship, but wasn't very serious about doing it as a profession. It just seemed a little frivolous, kind of dumb. I didn't know how I would be able to provide for a family with it. And by that time, I was married, and I had to start thinking seriously about my future and what it is I wanted to do. And I'll never forget this day that I had an appointment with my college counselor. And back then, they may still do this, I don't know, but back then you would go and you would take a test with your college counselor. And you would fill out a bunch of questions and things about yourself. And the goal of the test was to tell you what kind of a career you would be best suited for. So I filled out the test with my counselor, and I gave her the results. And, you know, again, this was 20 years ago, so they weren't processed immediately. I had to make an appointment to come back and find out my results. So I came back a couple days later, and my counselor was really nervous. She just seemed really shifty. And she said, well, she was shuffling papers. I have your results, and we should talk about them. And so I sat down with her and I said, well, let me know what I got. And she's like, well, according to the test, your first best occupation is circus performer. And the second one was like lawyer and then teacher after that. But I still have the printout. The first one is circus performer, which makes me laugh in so many ways because I think, first of all, how is that in the database? Like, who decided circus performer was a legitimate enough career to just throw that into the database? And she was so horrified to tell me that I would be best suited as a circus performer and then maybe a lawyer. And anyway, I've got some back problems, so I didn't go into that. But I could have. And anyway, so then I wound up working sort of in the private sector. Actually, I worked in retail for a little while, but was very bored and felt unchallenged by that, and then found out about a master's program at the University of Exeter, which is in England, that was centered on directing Shakespeare. And I'd always loved Shakespeare, and I thought, well, it just kind of spoke to me, and so that's where I ended up. So that's enough about me and my strange history. I want to talk now, just kind of shift focus a little bit and talk about Shakespeare itself. And as I mentioned earlier, a lot of times when I bring up Shakespeare or I talk about Shakespeare, inevitably people's eyes sort of glaze over and they think, it's so boring. And that's what I hear more than anything. If I were to ask people, or just random people on the street, what do you think about Shakespeare? At least half of them would say, I don't get it, or it's boring. And in a lot of ways, I agree with them. Because I think sometimes it is difficult to understand. And I've certainly seen a lot of shows that were quite boring. There's a quote from Peter Brook who says, I am more easily bored with Shakespeare and have suffered more ghastly evenings with him than any other dramatist I know. And Peter Brook is one of the most famous Shakespearean directors in the world. And that tells you how a lot of us feel, that if Shakespeare isn't done the right way, if it isn't handled correctly, it's so boring. And I don't blame you for feeling bored, because a lot of times I feel bored too. But when it's done the right way, when it's done with life and connection, it suddenly becomes the most amazing thing in the world. And I've actually invited some actors up. Don't worry, you're not on the hook yet. I've invited some actors from our department. They're going to come up and perform for you a little bit later, so you'll get a chance to see what we call original practice Shakespeare. And I'm going to talk about that in a second. But original practice is basically just saying, this is the way Shakespeare was performed in Shakespeare's day. And it's vastly different than what we see today. But let's go back to the whole introduction to Shakespeare thing. I think part of the reason why we think it's boring is because our introduction to it is oftentimes pretty boring. I remember for me, and I had some wonderful English teachers, but you know, my introduction to Shakespeare was sitting in my sophomore high school English class. Does this sound familiar? And everybody has a copy of the play, and it's kind of dog-eared, and you take turns, and you're going to be Juliet, and he's going to be Mercutio, and everybody's slowly reading it out loud in class. And it was so tedious and horrible. And so I always felt in high school that this stuff is so boring, especially Julius Caesar. We have to read Julius Caesar, and it is by far my least favorite Shakespeare play. Who's read Julius Caesar? Just do like this. I can't see your hands. There we go. Okay, no. Julius Caesar is so boring. It's three acts of people talking about what they're going to do, and then two acts of people talking about what they just did. And that's the play. And it's just, ugh. Also, there's nothing sexy in it. It's probably the cleanest of all Shakespeare's plays, and that's saying a lot. Shakespeare's very dirty and full of dirty jokes, but there are zero sexy, dirty jokes in Julius Caesar. And I think that school teachers pick that so they don't have to explain it to the kids, or so the kids don't look up all the dirty jokes and, oh, I got it. There's none of it. It's all politics. I hate it. So that's the problem with Julius Caesar. And I think also, you know, we are to blame ourselves a little bit because in terms of our entertainment, we can be a little bit lazy. Last week, Lisa, my wife, and I went to see Spider-Man 2. And, you know, I just sat, as I sat there watching it going, well, this is amazing, but I sure don't have to work very hard. because I just sit there while these things blow up in front of me and people scream and they fall off buildings and get electrocuted, and I just sit there lazily being entertained. But when you go to a play, and in particular when you go to a Shakespeare play, you have to work a little bit. You gotta like focus and you have to engage with it. But if you do it, it can be pretty astonishing. I don't know if you all know the actor Kevin Kline, but you probably remember him from A Fish Called Wanda, and I mean, he's done lots of other things. But he has a great quote. He says, talking about his experience with Shakespeare in high school. He says, "I remember our teacher sent us to see a local production at the University of King Lear, and I just made out with my girlfriend and then left." And that's Kevin Kline, who has made a living performing Shakespeare. So a lot of people have, maybe not that particular introduction, but a similar experience, that the way that we're introduced to Shakespeare is maybe not the most exciting. And so because of that, we have this preconceived notion that it's boring. When I was finishing up at BYU, I directed a Shakespeare company that would travel around the state and perform 50-minute cuttings of Shakespeare to school kids, elementary school kids. And we would easily see between 30 and 35,000 kids a year. And that would oftentimes be their first introduction to Shakespeare. And a lot of schools we went to were Title I schools, or schools where the predominant language was Spanish. And we were still doing these Shakespeare plays. And the crazy thing was, those kids got it. They laughed, they clapped, they'd get excited when exciting things happened. They weren't freaked out because nobody had told them yet that it was boring. They hadn't learned that yet. All they knew was that some people were coming to do a show, and it was pretty cool. And some people kissed, and they would freak out when they kissed. And then people would sword fight, and that was exciting. And they loved it. And that's the way the shows. These plays were written to be performed. They're not written to be read. We read them, and we study them, and that's great. But at the end of the day, these plays were written to be performed for an audience. I'm going to read a couple other quotes that I dug up just from people that I like. This is Michael Toledo, who's a director. And he's talking about learning to love Shakespeare. He says, "If there's a production near you, see it. If you're bored at the halfway point, the intermission, leave. But don't blame Shakespeare. Don't think that because you're bored, he's boring. It's our fault as actors. If you're bored, it's oftentimes our fault for boring you. Because we need to make it exciting and alive." Here's David Suchet, who's also a great actor. What is he in? He's in that Pierrot on PBS. You know, what is it? Poirot, Hercule Poirot, Monsieur Poirot. Yeah, he's an actor. He says, "My advice to anybody going to the theater, don't worry too much. Just make sure your ears are clean and your eyes are sharp. Listen and look and watch. Look at the distances people stand from each other. Look at the relationships being developed. Don't be put off if during the first 10 minutes you can't understand what's being said. Stay with it. Don't negate the move that Shakespeare will make toward your gut, toward your soul, because he will touch you there if you allow yourself to be touched." I always describe Shakespeare as like watching a foreign film. Many of you have had this experience where you watch a foreign film when there's subtitles, and for the first 10 minutes of it, you're going, "Oh, I gotta read these subtitles." I do it every time. And I just think, I can't follow what's happening because I'm so busy reading these subtitles. And then, after about 10 minutes, this magical thing happens where you forget that you're reading subtitles. Have you had that experience? And then, after the film is over, you think back, and you go, and you remember characters talking from the film, and you remember them talking in English. But they weren't. They were talking in French or Czechoslovakian or whatever the movie is. Shakespeare's the same way. It takes about 10 minutes to get in it. But once you're in it, you get it. You stop hearing Shakespeare and you start seeing a play. And that's why actors have to work twice as hard in the first 10 minutes as they do the whole rest of the play, because they have to suck you in and then they have to keep you there. But sucking you in is the really tricky part. Let's talk just briefly about Shakespeare himself. It's amazing how if you've often heard Shakespeare as being called the most prolific writer or the greatest writer who ever lived. And we have all these notions of who he was and what he did. But for someone so famous, there is an amazingly minute amount of information about the guy. We don't even know if he even existed. I'm not going to get into that. I could. That's another hour. We could talk about whether he actually existed. But there is a case to be made. All we know was that he was born on April 23rd, 1564, and he died on April 23rd, 1616. He died on his birthday. He was also born on his birthday, which is amazing. how many of you can claim that? And what happened in between is a little bit of a mystery. We know that his father was the alderman, which is like the town mayor. And then we also know that his father quit. He was the mayor, and halfway into his tenure, he quit being the mayor. He got really upset about something, and they think that what it was that he was upset about was that they were required back then to keep their dunghills in the back of their houses. Do you all know what a dunghill is? I'm glad you're not eating. I was worried you'd be eating while I was telling all these horrible things. A dunghill is where you put your human waste, and you put it in a bucket, and then you throw it in a big heap in the backyard. And then you might use it later as fertilizer or whatever. But Shakespeare's father kept his dunghill in the front of the house, so people saw it as they went by. And he refused to move it, and he got fined, and that hurt him, and he quit being mayor. It's kind of a baby. Just move it. It's not that big of a deal. Get a wheelbarrow, you know? But he was a man of principle with his dung heap. So, you know, as you should be. And so anyway, there's a theory that that's what happened there. His father was also, in addition to being the mayor, he was a glove maker, and he worked with leather and skinning and tanning animals. And Shakespeare probably apprenticed that way. His mother came from a little bit of a higher class family. She kind of married down when she married Shakespeare's father. They must have been in love. Shakespeare himself got married at age 18, and his fiancée was 26, and that was an old maid. If you were 26 and not married, there was something wrong with you, and what was wrong with her was that she was pregnant, which isn't that uncommon, but we know that she was pregnant because they had to quickly get married. So they got married. He lived in Stratford-upon-Avon, which was where he was born, for a little while, and then he disappeared. And this is an interesting thing. No one knows what happens to him in a period from about 3 to 5 years. There's no records. All we know is there's no records of him in his hometown, and there's no records of him anywhere else for about 4 or 5 years. They're called the lost years. And people have thought maybe he went away to be a lawyer because he talks a lot about law in his plays. Or maybe he went away to be a teacher because he comes back talking about teaching. Or maybe he was in the Navy because he knows a lot about all these other countries that he had never been to. Nobody knows. But he did disappear. And then he sort of reappears in the London scene, in the London theater houses. And initially, his job is to hold horses while people go to the play. So there's a record of a William Shakespeare who held horses. In other words, he's kind of like, what would you call that? Like a valet parking guy, yeah. So people pull up, they hand him their reins, and he holds them during the duration of the play. He works his way up, he becomes an actor. There are several Shakespeare plays that he acted in. In fact, they think he was Old Adam in As You Like It, and the ghost of Hamlet's father in Hamlet. And then he became a writer and a producer, and then he started making some real money. All we know is that there was a guy called William Shakespeare that wrote a bunch of plays, and then that person suddenly disappeared, and then a William Shakespeare reappeared back in Stratford-upon-Avon. So people just say, well, he retired and went back home, and that could be the case, or they could be two completely different William Shakespeares, and it's just a coincidence. Nobody knows. Nobody ever painted a painting of him. All those paintings you see of Shakespeare were done 50 to 100 years after his death. Nobody knows what the guy looks like. He may not have been bald. If he was lucky, he was bald, because it's an attractive quality in men. But he may not have been. You know, we just don't know. There are only six examples of his handwriting available, and it's signatures, his signature. That's all. And each one of the signatures is spelled a different way. So there's a mystery. He signed his name on legal documents, and he spelled it a different way every time. There are no, you might think that we have all these existing scripts written in Shakespeare's hand. We don't. There's nothing. The plays that we have are some kind of editor or writer sat in an audience and wrote down as the actors performed what they were saying. And if the actor screwed up his line that day, that's how it got written down, and that's what we have 400 years later. If the actor just started talking and just ad-libbing, improvising, that got written into the play, and that's what we have 400 years later. So it's pretty interesting. What we have today may not actually come from Shakespeare, and there may not have been a Shakespeare. So that's fascinating. It could be the world's greatest lie. It starts to feel like that horrible Nicolas Cage movie with the postage stamp. Or what is that? And it's on the Statue of Liberty. I never saw it. But, you know, it's some huge conspiracy, maybe, Shakespeare. You'll hear people say they don't think he existed, and you'll think that that person is a crackpot. But they're really not. There's a lot of evidence to suggest he never was even there. But we're going to pretend like he did for today, because someone wrote the plays, and whoever they were, they did a really great job. Now I want to talk about the thing that I think is the most exciting and probably will be the most disturbing to you. So fasten your seatbelts. I want to talk to you about Shakespeare's theater. So what it would be like to see a play in Shakespeare's day. Now, if you go to a play today, let's say you go down to the Utah Shakespeare Festival. No offense to them, they're wonderful, they do a nice job. But you're gonna go and you're gonna dress nicely, conservatively, and you're gonna sit quietly in the audience and you're gonna be really careful not to rustle your program. Or if you have a cough drop, you're gonna really slowly unwrap it so nobody hears, and you're gonna turn your cell phone off. And the audience is going to be about 90 years and older on average. And that's your experience of a Shakespeare play. It's my experience. Now, let's say you were able to time travel back 400 years, and you were able to go back and see Shakespeare in his own time and place. It would be a vastly, vastly different experience. The theaters were shaped like a giant O, like a giant circle, okay? And they were wooden, and there would be two balconies. Now, you've all probably seen what a Shakespeare stage looks like, but it's not much different than what I've got here, but maybe thinner. It's called a thrust stage. In other words, the stage thrusts out into the audience. So you've got an audience here, an audience here, and then you've got audience in these balconies, and you've got audience in these balconies. There were no fire codes then, so they would pack as many people as they could into the theater. If the theater burned down, it's your fault for going. Or lighting a fire, or smoking, or whatever caused the fire. I mean, you just took your chances, and it was all about making money. So they would smash as many people as they could, hundreds and hundreds of people. And of course, these people down here they're called groundlings because they're standing on the ground. They'd pay a penny and be able to stand to watch the show. Smashed in, they couldn't move their arms. There were no bathrooms. If you had to go to the bathroom, you just went right there. Yeah. That's just, it would be kind of nice in some ways. Maybe, I won't go into that any further. I just think it would be kind of nice. But anyway, if you had to go, you had to go. And bear in mind that these are people who bathed maybe once a year. We didn't know much about germs, so bathing was just kind of something you did to maybe feel better about yourself, which is why a lot of brides would get married in June, because they had just had their yearly bath in May. And they still smelled pretty okay. It's also why brides would carry bouquets, because the bouquet of flowers was meant to mask your smell as you were coming down the aisle. But these people did not smell good. They didn't smell great. So you have the bathroom situation. You have the body odor situation. You're smashed in there. It's a hot summer day. All the plays were performed during the day if they were outside. So it's hot. Those fumes are sort of rising. And people up in the balconies are just dropping like flies. They have all these clothes on, and the women have these really tight corsets that can't breathe. People are fainting. So that's going on. In the middle of the play, while the play is happening, you have people working the audience. So someone might be selling nuts. So it's like a baseball game. They'd be like, nuts! Anybody want nuts? You know, and Hamlet's up there drinking poison. And some dude is out there selling nuts. They would also sell puppies. This is really interesting. They would sell puppies if it were a colder day, because you could take the puppy and you would put it down your shirt and it was like a little hot water bottle. And then, when the show was over, you could just toss the puppy into the river. They were disposable dogs. The city was overrun with dogs. So you just would buy a puppy and done. It's amazing, right? These people. What else? Prostitutes? I won't go into this. Prostitutes, yes, working the crowd while the play is going on. That's happening. And then, you know, before the play even started, you'd have this entire pre-show. And the pre-show, this is pretty crazy. A lot of pre-shows would start off with a cockfight, which is where you put roosters on the stage and they fight, and you bid on it, and then they claw each other to death. Or they would do something called bear baiting, which is where you take a giant bear, and a real bear, like an animal bear, and you chain it to a pole. And then people bring their giant dogs, their mastiffs or whatever, and throw the dogs up on stage, and the dogs fight the bear. And then you would put money down on who you thought would last longer. A lot of times, you know, there would be 20 dogs on stage and one bear. And there was actually one of the biggest celebrities of the time was a bear. His name was Sackerson. Sackerson the Bear. And Sackerson gets mentioned in one of Shakespeare's plays. He was that big of a celebrity. He was like the Kardashians of that time. And Sackerson was able, for whatever reason, to just kill dog after dog after dog and was never defeated in bear baiting. Anyway, the point of that is, at the end of that session, you know, the stage would be littered with ears and teeth and fur and, of course, blood or feathers or beaks or bills or whatever, and someone would come out and just sweep it all off into the audience and clean the stage off. So the audience would be spattered with all of that. And then the play would start. This is all before the... Do you get where I'm going with this? It's just not the same today. We just don't do that stuff. I wish we did, as I mentioned earlier with the bathroom thing, but I wish we did, and I wish that we could approximate that experience because it's so exciting for me. Now, if I'm an audience member and I want to come see the show, I pay whatever I can afford, and that will dictate where I sit. It's the same thing today. If I'm really wealthy, I could sit up in the balcony. And it's a horrible view of the show, but it doesn't matter because everybody can see what I look like, and they can see my fancy new tights or my doublet or whatever it is I got going on. It's a way of showing off. So that's what rich people did. So imagine you've got Romeo and Juliet, and Juliet's up there on her balcony, and she has to sort of squeeze past people to say her lines. If you were very wealthy, you could afford to buy a seat right on the stage. So imagine that. You're just sitting there watching the play, and the actors are doing circles around you. And, you know, you're wealthy. You can do that. So all of that's going on. These actors had to work so hard to keep that audience's attention. Because if they let up for a moment, they would lose that audience. That audience could get distracted by a nut seller, a puppy seller, a prostitute. Oh, I didn't even tell you the best one. Let me tell you the best one. You're going to think I'm making this up. If I were a lady and I had a crush on one of the actors, remember all the men were men on stage. All the actors were men. If I had a crush on one of the actors, I would create a love apple. And a love apple is where you take an apple or a pear and you put it in your armpit, and you let it sit there for 3 or 4 days, sleep with it, maybe tie a ribbon around to keep your arm down, and it soaks up all of your juices. Then you come to the theater, you take out the love apple, and you toss it to the actor on stage that you like. And that guy grabs it, he smells it. If he likes the smell, he invites you backstage afterwards for a date. If he really likes you, he might take a bite of it. Yeah, I was hoping you'd make that noise. I didn't make any of this up. So that's all going on. These actors had to compete with all of that. And so what they had to do, it was imperative that they connect. They had to connect with their audiences. They had to look them in the face. They had to reach them. They had to touch them. They could not ignore them. And the show had to be about that audience, because once it became about them and their fancy performance, they lost them. And if you lost an Elizabethan audience and they didn't like you, they'd beat you up pretty hard behind the theater after the show, or in some cases, kill you. There were some actors many actors who had little tricks where if they felt like they were losing the attention of the audience, they would stop the play and do some little trick. So they would juggle knives, or they would do acrobatics across the stage. And it didn't matter. I mean, you could be in the middle of the saddest scene, but if you felt like your audience was bored, you would just stop and just start juggling knives. And then once you got everybody's attention back, you'd go back to that sad scene again. Because it was all about keeping that audience entertained. There's one terrible story that I have to say, where there was a gentleman actor who his trick was to, he would light himself on fire. And he, if he felt like the audience was getting bored, he would grab a torch or something and light himself on fire and run around the stage screaming. And then he'd put himself out and go back on with the play. And there was one fateful day where he could not put himself out. And he burned to death in front of the audience. And they loved it. This is that time period. This is what people wanted when they came to the theater. So again, as I said before, the actors had to work so hard to stay connected, to build that connection and keep that connection with the audience, or the play would have been a disaster. And it's pretty impressive. That's a little bit what we've lost. Over the course of 400 centuries, we've lost that. Shakespeare's become sort of a, I might even say an upper class institution, an educated world, a place where people go very politely and quietly and respectfully. But we've lost that violence, that passion, that athleticism that we used to have with Shakespeare. Some of it, thankfully, is gone. We don't do the pears or the love apples, and we don't really murder anybody if we don't like their performance. We want to, but we don't. But we've also lost a lot of that excitement, enthusiasm for Shakespeare and the way it should be performed. And in some cases, it's pretty sad. When I was working at, when I was studying at the University of Exeter in my graduate program, I was able to do an internship and work for a little bit at the Globe Theatre in London. And I worked with a man named Mark Rylance, who is a famous stage actor. He's a really great guy. And he was a tough guy to work for, because we would be up on stage. My job was to perform for these tour groups that would go through the Globe Theatre in London. And we'd get up and we'd do these little scenes and monologues for them. And if we ever got bored and just went through the motions, or if we ever started ignoring the audience, he would call us on it like that and say, "You cannot do that. That is not what we do here at the Globe. Our job is to connect. We connect to the audiences, we look them in the eyes, we give them an experience that they will never forget." And he was tough on us. And I learned so much from that. I want to introduce you to, now, finally, you guys can do something. But before you do, I want to introduce you to Daniel Whiting. And this Daniel Whiting is sitting on the front row. He's a staff member here at UVU. He works in our scenic shop. And Dan and a few other gentlemen a couple of years ago decided to create a Shakespeare company called the Grassroots Shakespeare Company. And the entire thing is rooted in original practice, the stuff that I've been talking to you about connecting to the audience, about looking at them, interacting with them. And so I'm going to invite him up and have him talk to you just a little bit about what it is that Grassroots does, and then we're going to see a couple performances. Are you guys ready for that? Okay, good. So come on up, Dan.
Hey, guys. So I think Chris really just invited me here to take up some of his time, because he could have definitely told you everything I'm about to. But I'm going to just give you a brief introduction to Grassroots Shakespeare, to the Grassroots Shakespeare Company, who we are and what we strive to do. And then you'll get to see some of our actors who, coincidentally, for the most part, were all students here at UVU. Our mission statement says that Grassroots is a collaborative touring ensemble of multidisciplinary artists who create joyous, vibrant productions inspired by Shakespeare's original staging techniques. Through open-air performances, interactive workshops, and scholarly events, we produce and promote genuinely engaging, popular, and relevant theater. That's really what we try to do the most, is to create engaging and relevant Shakespeare. And like Chris said, it's something that's kind of lacking in Shakespeare in general. In fact, Reed Farnsworth, who writes for the Deseret News, came and saw one of our shows and then wrote this in an article afterwards. If Shakespeare was taught this way in schools, it would be an extremely popular class, which is one of my favorite things anyone has ever said about the work that we do. So the Grassroots Shakespeare Company started 5 years ago. We turned five this spring, which is very exciting for us. We were the brainchild, thank you, of two students, alumni here at UVU, Alex Ungerman and Mark Oram, who've both gone on to do some pretty amazing things. They were in a play that Chris directed at the Hale Center Theater, As You Like It, and he kind of did some of this original practice staging type stuff, and they got very excited. And along with some of the other people who were in that show, which I think some of the actors you're gonna see were, they started this company, and they kind of swept me on board at that point. So we were kind of some of the original founding members of this theater company. Over the 5 years that we've existed, we've performed, we specialize in touring. So we try to put on, Chris has kind of talked about the shows that happen just in one location, but another big part of the Elizabethan Theater was these touring companies, which would literally just roll into some town, throw up a couple of wine barrels, put some planks across them, and do a show, and hopefully the audience would pay them. Sometimes the town council would pay them not to perform the show, depending on the situation. And so that's kind of what we do. We tour around the state and perform. And in the 5 years that we've existed, we've performed over 20 different plays. Some of those have been remounts of old plays. We started three other sister companies. So we have a company in Alabama that's currently rehearsing Romeo and Juliet, and we have a London-based company that just sold out their Othello in Leicester Square. We're very excited about that. And right now, between the three companies, we're actually performing five different plays and have three in rehearsals. So over those 5 years, we've experienced a lot of growth, and we're continuing to expand. But a lot of that growth is because we're presenting Shakespeare in a way it's never been presented before. Well, that's not true. In a way that it was meant to be presented and was originally presented in, but that was kind of lost. And hopefully our actors will show you what I'm talking about a little bit, and you can definitely come and check out one of our shows if you're interested. We're performing around Utah Valley quite a bit this summer. Let's see if there's anything else that I should hit on before I move on. Did I miss anything? Anything else to say? So that's who we are. We're the Grassroots Shakespeare Company. Oh, something else I wanted to mention is that this company is run by eight current UVU students, nine UVU graduates, and five BYU graduates, all of which were just students when we started the company. And we started this company and have been able to nourish it to the point it's at because of the support that we received largely in part from Chris Clark and Kate McPherson, who is an honor Shakespeare teacher here at UVU. They've really supported us, encouraged us, helped us write grants, and got us to the point that we're at. I don't know if this would have ever happened without the support of the university, so thanks to them. And that's it.
So I'm gonna invite the actors up to do a little something for you. Why don't you all just come up and we'll take turns, how's that? There are four of them, all attired a little differently. Amber Dodge is the first one coming up. She's cheating because she's a woman. And in Shakespeare's day, there would have been no women on stage. And as you see right behind Amber is Davy Morrison, who is a man. And he will be playing a woman. I think Amber's doing a piece from A Winter's Tale.
Mm-hmm.
And then Davy Morrison and Jason Sullivan will do a scene from The Taming of the Shrew, which you may be familiar with. We actually just did it here on campus, where Petruchio beats up Kate. It's misogynistic, it's horrible. And then Dan Anderson on the end is going to do a piece from The Tempest, Prospero. So Amber, you wanna go first?
Yeah.
Okay.
What studied torments, tyrant, hast thou for me? What wheels, racks, fires, what beatings, flayings, boilings in lead or oils, what old or newer torture must I receive whose every word deserves to taste of thy most worst? Thy tyranny, working together with thy jealousies, fancies too weak for boys, too green and idle for girls of nine. Oh, think what they have done and run mad indeed, stark mad. For all thy bygone fooleries were but spices of it. That thou betrayest Polixenes was nothing. That did but show thee of a fool, constant, damnable, ingrateful, nor was much that thou wouldst to poison good Camillo's honor to have him kill a king. But last, O lords, cry woe when I have said. The queen, the dearest, sweetest creature is dead, and vengeance for it not yet dropped down. I say she's dead. I'll swear it. If you can bring tincture or luster to her lip, heat outwardly or breath within, I will serve you as I do the gods. But O thou tyrant, repent not of these things, for they are heavier than all thy woes can stir. Therefore betake thee to nothing but despair. Thank you.
You could see, come on. You could see with that, you know, you didn't understand every word, but you could definitely feel it, couldn't you? You could tell what was going on, and then you found out the queen was dead, and you understood that. And this is what they're doing. They're connecting with you. They're looking at you, and they're talking to you. They're not ignoring you. This is a little bit what we're talking about. Come on.
I will attend her here and woo her with some spirit when she comes. Say that she rail. Why, then, I'll tell her straight. She sings as sweetly as a nightingale. Say she be mute and will not speak a word, then I'll commend her volubility. If she deny to wed, I'll crave the day when I shall ask the banns and when be married. But here she comes. And now, Petruchio, speak. Good morrow, Kate, for that's your name, I hear.
Well, have you heard, but something hard of hearing? They call me Katerina that do talk of me.
You lie, in faith, for you are called plain Kate, and bonny Kate, and sometimes Kate the Cursed, but Kate, the prettiest Kate in Christendom. Kate of Kate Hall, my super dainty Kate, for dainties are all Kates, and therefore, Kate, hearing thy mildness praised in every town, thy virtue spoke of, and thy beauty sounded, myself am moved to woo thee for my wife.
Oh, moved in good time! Let him that moved you hither remove you hence! I knew you at the first, you were a movable.
Why, what's a movable?
A joined stool.
Thou hast hit it. Come, sit on me.
Asses are made to bear, and so are you.
Women are made to bear, and so are you.
Oh, no such jade as you, if me you mean.
Come, come, you wasp. If faith, you are too angry.
Oh, if I be waspish, best beware my sting.
My remedy is then to pluck it out.
Aye, if the fool could find it where it lies.
Who knows not where a wasp does wear his sting? In his tail.
Oh, in his tongue.
Whose tongue?
Yours, if you talk of tails, and so farewell.
Nay, with my tongue in your tail? Come again, good Kate, I am a gentleman.
That I'll try, huh?
I swear I'll cut you if you strike again.
Oh, if you strike me, you are no gentleman.
Nay, hear you, Kate. In sooth, you scape not so.
Oh, I chafe you. If I tarry, let me go.
Nay, not a whit. I find you passing gentle.
Oh,
'twas told me you were rough and coy and sullen, but now I find report a very liar. For thou art pleasant, gamesome, passing courteous, with gentle conference, soft and affable.
Where did you learn all this goodly speech?
It is extempore from my mother wit.
Oh, a witty mother, witless else her son.
Am I not wise?
Yes, keep you warm.
Marry, so I mean, sweet Katerina, in thy bed. And therefore, setting all this chat aside, thus in plain terms, your father hath consented that you shall be my bride, your dowry agreed on. For I am he, am born to tame you, Kate, and bring you from a wild Kate to a Kate conformable as other household Kates. Here comes your father. Never make denial. I must and will have Katerina to my wife. Thank you.
It's so fun when we can see a man play a woman's part, because that's how they did it. And you know, you had that little joke in there of her pulling your chest hair, and you could have done the same thing to her, and it would have had the same joke. There was a really dirty joke in there, by the way. Did you catch it? Okay, good. You're so smart. I'm not going to tell you what it was, but it was okay. Dan.
Ye elves of hills, brooks, dales, standing lakes and groves, and ye that on the sands with printless foot do chase the ebbing Neptune and do fly him when he comes back. You demi-puppets that by moonshine do the green sour ringlets make whereof the ewe not bites, and you whose pastime is to make midnight mushrooms that do rejoice to hear the solemn curfew. By whose aid have I given fire, rifted Jove's stout oak with his own bolt? The strong-based promontory have I made shake, and by the spurs plucked up the pine and cedar. Graves at my command have waked their sleepers, oped and led them forth by my so potent art. But this rough magic I here abjure. I'll break my staff, bury it certain fathoms in the earth, and deeper than did ever plummet sound, I'll drown my books. Thank you.
That's old Prospero in The Tempest. He's casting a spell. That's beautifully done. Let's give them all one big round of applause. Man, thanks, guys. It was really good. What they're doing, if you couldn't tell, is trying to connect with you. They're looking at you. They're talking to you. They came down into the audience, and they got right up in your face. They didn't excuse you from having this experience. They wanted you to be part of it. I'll never forget, briefly, when I was working at the Globe, I told you that I had performed for tour groups. And one of the scenes I did was a character named Dr. Caius, who's this outlandish Frenchman with this really thick, horrible French accent. And he comes out, and he spits, and he screams, and he stamps and he speaks French, and audiences loved it. They thought it was so funny. And there was one day where I came out and there was a group gathered around the stage, and I did my French thing and I was crazy, and they were not buying it. And I was patting them on the head and I was trying to pull them up on stage. Nothing. No laughs, nothing. And I was working so hard to connect with them, and then finally someone goes, "Stupid." And I realized they were French. It was a French tour group. And I was completely insulting them, and oh well, I tried. But that idea of connection is so important, because that's what helps us engage. I oftentimes feel that way as a faculty member, as a teacher, that my job in the classroom is to connect, it's to engage. And I think it's what we do in just about anything. We reach out in some way and connect with another person. We engage with them, and we give them an experience, and they give us this experience. And when we have that communal experience, it's really, really fantastic. It's terrifying to get up and perform for people. You'd be surprised how many actors get nervous. But there's something so rewarding about getting up in front of someone and telling them a story and drawing them into a world and taking them somewhere that makes it all worth it. Actors get horrible stage fright. I want to read just one last quote from an actress named Claire Bloom. She's talking about what it feels like before she steps on stage to become Juliet in Romeo and Juliet. She says, "I know the house lights have gone half to black, then to black. The opening music for Romeo and Juliet. The curtain rises. The audience applauds the set. The Duke of Verona speaks. It is happening. I feel slightly sick, and have to remind myself just how many years I've wanted this. I want to weep and go home. I hear my cue. I have to force myself into action as though I am about to plunge into a freezing sea. I run across the stage towards my mother and my nurse. I'm distracted for a moment by the brief applause that greets my appearance. Then everything begins to fade except the reality of the play. I feel that I have a wonderful story to tell." I think that's how we feel a lot of times as actors, is we feel like we've got these wonderful stories. It is scary stepping out there. I love how she says, it's like, you know that horrible feeling before you jump in the swimming pool? You've already put your foot in it. You know how cold it's going to be, but you have to do it. It sometimes feels like that stepping out on stage, but then suddenly you're in the water and it feels great. And we recognize, I think, the value in telling stories. But even more than that, we recognize the value of telling Shakespeare stories, because his stories are about human beings having human experiences. And it's exciting. And I think we're very lucky to be able to do what we do, but we're also very lucky to have audiences who come and want to have that participatory experience with us. It's exciting, and I'm happy that it has become my life. And thank you.
Was he boring?
So.
Thank you so much. Christopher Layton, yes. Clark. Yes.
Thank you. Thanks,
Chris. And thank you to our incredible students. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I love being in the School of the Arts and working with fantastic faculty and wonderful students. We're so lucky there that we do get to make a difference. We make these connections not only between faculty and students, but students and audience. And that's what it's all about in the theater department. So thank you again. I don't know about you, but that hour went fast for me. But let me make a plug for the project Chris was talking about, the Romeo and Juliet project. This next season, we are going to be performing Romeo and Juliet live on the stage up in the Norder. But as part of that project, there will be the film, and they're combining the film and the live stage production together. So make sure you come and support our incredible students and our wonderful theater department. As some of you may also know, we're trying to raise money for a building. So how many of you would be willing to give $5 to see Chris Clark shirtless? Okay, we have our building paid for. Oh, more than five. 10? 20? No question. Okay, we're now ready for the rest of summer university. You have workshops this evening. Hopefully you know what direction you're going. And tomorrow, a report for your service projects. We'll then be having lunch here in the ballroom. And you then will be seeing our wonderful summer university movie, which our guys up in the studio are finishing off right now. So, thank you.